Hey, it's Tim here. A lot of people say that you need async Rust to write high-performance web services, and I want to show you that's not actually accurate. I don't want to say that what I'm about to demonstrate is the only way or the best way to write web services with Rust. However, I do want to show you that it's an actual valid option. Okay, so I'm going to use a little framework called Roué, which is French for rusty. And Roué has quite a simple API, in fact, almost minimalistic. You start by creating a server that listens at an address, and I'll say localhost 10,000. And then you specify a handler, which will be which I'm going to use as an anonymous function that accepts some request, and it's req. And then its job is to return a response and text, and I'll, instead of printing hello internet, I will send that back as my text, and I'll just add r-n, and that is my web service. Let's see what this looks like. Cargo run. That takes a little bit of time to compile, but that's okay. It's Rust. And we don't have to worry about async at all. We don't have an async runtime. Every single request gets given its own thread. And we have a compile warning saying, hey, you've not actually worried about this request variable. I'll pass on that for now. We'll fix it up just in a second. But if I go to another terminal, curl localhost 10,000, correctly spell the name of the host, I get hello internet. So this is my little web server serving a request. Again, it's extremely minimalistic, but I'm going to show you a couple of extra features of the framework to provide some more of the functionality that you would normally be accustomed to. I just want to show you that it's really, really fast. So I am recording this live. I'm recording this live. That involves a whole bunch of video encoding and a lot of processing on the part of the thing on the computer, but it's still able to perform 17,000 operations per second. And that's quite fast for most web services. I think we can do a little bit better. By default, the framework will try to use all threads on the system. But if I say, actually, I only want some subset, this computer has 12, and I will just reserve 6 for the web server. And then the benchmarking system also required a few threads. So I'm sure that there was a little bit of contention there. And let's rerun the benchmarks for 10 seconds and see whether or not performance was better or worse. It's also very uncommon. About 17,000 requests per second. So, you know, not awful. I just want to show off something else. So let's create our first, just create a custom structure. And we will call it jam jar. And inside our jam jar will be a flavor. And call it a string. And then let's say we might have a volume in, I don't know, whichever unit you prefer. I'll leave that up to you, whether or not you prefer metric or imperial. So we've got our jam jar with a flavor, and I'll just create a little helper application. I'll just leave it there. And so what we want to do is convert our jam jar into JSON. Role a JSON function that will take some content, and that could be our jam jar here. And as long as it implements a trait that we haven't yet introduced, we'll just say raspberry do you like prefer strawberry jam? That's okay. Well, maybe you prefer strawberry jam. And volume would be 255 mils, let's say, which I think is 8 ounces. I'm not sure. So we've got a jar. This isn't quite enough. As I said, the compiler is expecting our type to implement a trait. So if we bring up the error message, let's say I'll consider borrowing. So that's another difference. And there should be a trait bound thing saying we haven't implemented serialized. So how do I do that? First of all, I need to make sure that surday is in cargo.toml version 1, and we include the derive feature. Now I can come over to my code, use surday, and then we want the serialize trait and proc macro actually. And now I can derive debug, which is nice for printing output, but it's not essential for right now, serialize. Again, we ignore the request. We'll get to that shortly. And now we're in a position where code should compile. So close the old server and run. Ah, I know what I would have forgotten. I would have forgotten release. And so that was running at 17,000 requests per second, just under the debug mode. And so now I have a new web server that is serving jam jars. And I've got the dash V for verbose to provide the headers from the command line, sorry, from the server. But let's just check very quickly how long it takes for this framework and Rust to be able to take some data in memory. Now we get a much sounder performance. We're at 43,000 requests per second, so over double just by adding dash dash release. And by the way, we're actually doing more work than just sending back a text file, a hello internet message, because we're actually converting jam jar into JSON every time. Cool. Okay. Now you're thinking, well, actually, I want to connect it to a specific route. Role is Roi. I actually haven't got my French pronunciation correct. So if you would like to correct me, please do. Provides a macro that takes as its first argument the request. And then it kind of has this syntax, which is a little bit like pattern matching, where we have a method and then a handler. And the syntax requires that we specify a method and then a route. So this is our index. And let's just say right now we specify a response and I want it empty 204, which is an empty request that is successful. And in the, then I want jam to be my JSON response. And to do that, I specify my code that I had before in the context of this little nested loop. Now let's just check if that is correct. We get a compiler error. The issue is that there are no rules expected. So we haven't quite got the syntax for the macro correct. I'll just pause and figure that out. Thing is, the right-hand side of these match expressions really want all of the routes inside the curly braces. But I've still got a compiler error. You can see by the squiggly line here. Unexpected macro invocation. Ah, while trying to match underscore. So we need a default. And that will be a response. And then empty 404. File not found. And request local variable. Cool. We now have a web application that sends back some data about jam jars and it does nothing, or at least it sends an empty 204 response in the case of So, oh, actually, I need to recompile and rebuild. So this, here we go. Our code's compiling. And the first route will do nothing. And if we look at the headers, you'll see that the HTTP response was 204 no content, which is exactly what we asked for. We can ask for jam and probably get some strawberry jam back. And if you want to see that last missing 404, here's our empty 404 with the correct HTTP header in play. Okay, so this is only the very small fragment of the tiniest little service that you might like to put on the internet, but I did want to demonstrate that it is a perfectly valid option and that there's no requirement to go for async if your use case doesn't need it. And in most cases, your deployment story, where you're going to deploy your application, will be on a little cloud server that is serving some internal API, maybe a couple of times an hour, or you know, even 50 times per second. And even at that sort of level, an approach like this is perfectly acceptable. You can get well over 10,000 requests per second using something like this. And if you do exceed the performance and you want to refactor, you can always throw a load balancer in front of it and spin up more instances on the back end. It's really not that complicated. And that's it. Okay, so hopefully I'm not going to get totally flamed for my relatively inflammatory message that async isn't always needed. Okay, cheers, bye.